Welcome to Death Valley. There it is, the mysterious racetrack. The playa where the rocks go sailing. It's about 30 miles of bad road getting in here from Ubihibi Crater to the north. Well, here it is, the mysterious racetrack playa. There's an island out there in the middle they call the grandstand. Smooth and slick. Okay, here's a good example of one here. You can just barely make out in the light here today the skid mark this guy's making to this point here. Looks like he's been sitting here for a while. But he's traveled down from the north. So this playa, when wet, just becomes slicker than snot on a glass doorknob. And then some student researchers have finally solved the mystery. You get some rain in here, moisture, and then a freeze, and then you've got a slick enough surface where these rocks will start moving if a high enough wind event happens, and it'll move these rocks, and they'll still leave these little trace skid marks of their journey. There, you can kind of see it now. And the skid marks aren't always straight. Sometimes they curve around. Let's see if we can see it kind of coming that way. Very rare and interesting phenomenon. Probably one of the 8 wonders of the world. The sailing rocks on the racetrack playa here in Death Valley. Here you can see a couple of skid marks or contrails off of these rocks, indicating a wind from the north blowing these guys to the south. And look how it's just been setting for quite some time now. That's a lot of rock to move. And the surface area to get the enough aerodynamic drag to push these things around, and it would require a real slick surface to start moving these things. We've had some rains out here recently, but not so much wind to move, or freezing to move them around, so that's kind of obscured the skid marks a little bit. Absolutely silent out here. So we'll take the road to Lippincott out this way, and then hang a right and see if we can find our way up to Saline Warm Springs. It's a long way out here. Beautiful. Now there's no camping, no off-road riding, no motorized anything off of this road. You can only just come down here and take a look at this. You can't spend the night. So it's an all-day affair to come on down here and check it out. It's a long, slow slog on this washboardy road. Even in your four-wheel drive, even on the dirt bike, I can only make about 30 miles an hour to keep from rattling everything to pieces. And like I said, it's 30 miles to the pavement up there and another 60 miles of pavement back to camp. Saline Warm Springs is way down there. Boy, coming down this Lippincott pass is super scenic. It's almost as cool as a Dante's view, but a lot rockier. Of course, nice rocky road with precipitous drop-offs, but it's real easy on the 690 so far. It would really get your wife's attention if you came up here in a four-wheel drive car. Whoo, there's some drop-offs the edge. Now I can see how this Lippincott Pass Road is just one washout away from being gone forever, because there's no mining activity up here to support this road, and the Park Service wants to get people out of the national parks, and so they won't maintain this road. And so you'll have to, it'll be up to a consortium of four-wheel drive folks and other motorized people working together with the government probably to repair these roads in the event of a giant washout and allow motorized access to continue. But Steel Pass, just to the north of us, has been washed out, and the Park Service wants nothing to do with repairing it and would rather just have that road go away forever. That's just not right. We need public access to public lands. Okay, enough of my soapbox. But I think that's important. Future generations, man, how are they going to get out here and see this? Well, this is Saline Valley Road, one of the longest continuous dirt roads in California. Over 120 miles, we're looking north now, from Big Pine, California, through the Saline Valley, which is what we're in now, Panamint Mountains right over there, all the way down to the highway into Death Valley. If you've ever been down this road before, you remember it. It is a long, slow, rough slog, and a lot of broken down vehicles have passed this way. So we're gonna work around that playa there and find the Saline Valley Hot Springs right up in there. There's also an airstrip up there called the Chicken Strip, so you could bypass all this bumpiness if you wanna fly into the gravel strip right there. The only catch is you're in the China Lake military operations area, which you're legal to fly in, but you're gonna have F-18s ripping right around your head, right down low level here. They put on a great air show. Saline Valley, Saline Valley Road, Death Valley. Fat Rock Road, the way to the Saline Valley Hot Springs. You can just see the oasis of trees up there in the distance. 5 miles ahead. Neat looking sculptures here. Ah, made it. The Palm Spring in the Saline Warm Springs. This is one of my favorites. Pots right here. There's another pot right over there. And another whole big oasis down there. Just bubbles on out into the desert. So the story with this place, this is another place that's endangered by the Park Service. Apparently back in the 50s, a swimming contractor came out here and blew holes in the ground and got these hot springs flowing and then gunited up these pools. And people have been enjoying them for years. But the Park Service doesn't agree. They don't think it's a natural part of the park, and they are is a constant battle to try and get these things closed off. So we got to fight to keep it open. That's another public access to public lands battle. It's always going on. So I'm going to take a little dip. Here's the history of the place. Looks like 1967 they got going on it. Concrete batch plant operations, operators. 1967, 1968. So it wasn't the 50s, it was the late 60s. They got this going. Mighty fine. La Vida Loca. Saline Hot Springs. Long way out here. You come all the way out here, you're gonna want to spend a week. Quite a few days anyways. There's nothing out here. Absolutely no amenities. You have to bring absolutely everything in and pack it out. And enjoy the air show ahead above. All the jets in the China MOA are operating day and night overhead. Other than that, there's nothing out here but some wild burrows. Well, it's a real crying ass shame to have to leave now. About 3 in the afternoon, got about 100 miles to go back to camp, 60 miles to gas. I've been at it for 130 miles so far today, so that'll be a 200 mile fuel range. Hopefully the 690 can make it. So what's that, almost, well, 250 mile probably total day today. Last 50 miles is paved though. All right, hate to leave Saline Valley Warm Springs. I'd much rather just come up here and camp out. But we'll be back. And next time I'm going to fly into the chicken strip is right over there, a little airstrip, a little gravel airstrip. That's another thing that the park wants to get rid of and not be responsible for is the little airstrip here at the hot springs, known as the chicken strip. I got some footage of the chicken strip last time I was out here. Show you what that looks like. Here's a neat spot, an easy spot to get to in Death Valley. Artist Palette. They've got this neat little paved loop drive and gets you up to these interesting rock formations right up here. Not far from Badwater Basin, the lowest point in the Northern Hemisphere. And then the mountains behind us here, Dante's View is right up there, over 5,000 feet overlooking Badwater Basin. Well, I'm in the heart of Death Valley here at one of the most amazing stories of a location of one of the most amazing stories of survival in American history and selfless heroism on the part of some California pioneers in 1849. I'm located right across from Badwater Basin, is right over there, 300 feet below sea level, the lowest point in Death Valley, the lowest point, probably in the Northern Hemisphere. And right across from Telescope Peak, which towers above about 12,000 feet in the Panamint Range. This is the location of the Bennett Arcane Long Camp. This is the location where the pioneers that got stuck in Death Valley ended up camping out for over a month, sleeping underneath what was left of the wagons and surviving off of the oxen as they died off, while they waited for William Manley and John Rogers, a couple of young trappers that had walked with these pioneers all the way into Death Valley from the Midwest. Manley and Rogers walked from here all the way to Los Angeles, San Fernando Valley, to get provisions and help, and walked all the way back to rescue the Bennett and Arcane family. Manley told the party remaining behind that he estimated 15 days he'd be back. It took him over a month to get back, and yet the party that remained on the site survived. A few of the party got impatient, left the site, and promptly died of thirst. This all happened in the December of 49, I believe it was, and so at least the temperature was like it is today. It's pretty mild here, but still nothing to eat except for the oxen. There is water out here if you dig for it, and they get this terrible alkali water, and that's what they were able to survive off of. After the party was rescued, they went on to participate in the gold rush and the rest of California history and lived a long, fulfilling life, thanks to the help of the selfless help of William Manley and John Rogers. An amazing story. Man, have you ever seen the desert this green before? This is just gonna burst with wildflowers. They've had a lot of good rain lately. We're heading westbound to Striped Butte right over there and Mangle Pass. That'll drop us down into Ballarat, then north back up to Panamint Springs. So this is Mangle Pass, one of the ways out of Death Valley, over to Ballarat, Trona, and eventually Southern California. And this was part of the escape route that our pioneers took to get out of Death Valley. Now, how did they get in Death Valley in the first place? Well, they wanted to ride on the old Spanish Trail or walk on the old Spanish Trail. They were trying to find that and they wandered into Death Valley instead. Manly was so naive about Western geography, he figured somewhere around the Green River, he'd built himself a dugout canoe and started floating down the Green River, figured he'd just float to the California gold fields. Then some old Indians finally found him and said, "You're not going to make it down here. When this turns into the Colorado River, you just cannot do it. You got to go back up to Salt Lake City and walk to California." Well, the pioneers were deathly afraid of Salt Lake City and the Mormons. The Mormons had been terrifying pioneers as they came through their territory. The Mormon massacre and events like that really scared the immigrants from Salt Lake City. But Manly did go up to Salt Lake City and then headed steadily southwest until he stumbled into Death Valley here with the Bennett and Arcane party. Burros was the only thing that worked here in the Death Valley. The horses didn't last very long at all, and so that's why today you still see these wild burros, which are direct descendants from the pioneers that came through Death Valley in 1849. Nice and quiet out here today. Well, here's an interesting piece of Death Valley notoriety. Kind of just outside the park now, towards Ballarat. You all know what this place is? The Parker Ranch. Yep, that's right. The final hideout of Charlie Manson. Not long ago, the ranch was still complete. But recently, unfortunately, arsonists have burned it down. Fireplace. It's believed that in the kitchen here, Charlie Manson was captured, cowering under some cabinets in here. At the Barker Ranch, right on the edge of Death Valley. It is a little secret turnoff to find this place. Got to get the right draw off the main road to Mangle Pass. Not too easy to find. Welcome to Ballarat, California. Population, we don't know. coldest drinks in town. Usually you can stop by and get a beer here, but the caretaker seems to be out right now. Another ghost town, mining town. But the one claim to fame is laying out here. Local legend has it that this was Charlie Manson's power wagon. I don't know if that's true or not. Still sitting here in Ballarat. It's got these stars painted inside of here. Probably somebody has since painted it. Is that Charlie's power wagon? Did he even have a power wagon? I mean, this is the last place, the last stop, basically, before you head off to his ranch. The Barker Ranch, his hideout. It was never his ranch. He just squatted there. Pressers, pumps, engines, carts. Ballarat jail and morgue and motel if vacant. Hey, the door is open today. Oh yeah. All the comforts of home. Huh. Windows of history. So if you head up there, you go to, not Manly's Pass, but Rogers Pass, where Manly and Rogers got out of Death Valley, and I think Mrs. Bennett or Mrs. Arcane turned around and looked back over the valley and said, "Farewell, Valley of Death." And thus, Death Valley got its name. One other thing I wanted to mention is why did Manly and so many of the folks in 1849, 50, take the, try to get on the old Spanish Trail? Well, they had heard about the Donner Party and all the travails of the deep snow in the Sierras, so they wanted to avoid that. So they came down south and got stuck in Death Valley instead. Of course, not all the pioneers, just these few parties. Now, Manly himself had such a grand adventure walking out to the California Gold Rush that he, after the Gold Rush, he went all the way around through the Panama Canal at the time, and back to up the Mississippi River and back to his home in the Midwest, his farm, and immediately found farm life just too damn boring. So he just turned around and came right back out to California, got back in the middle of the Gold Rush, helped to establish Moore's Flat right there by Nevada City, between Nevada City and Allegheny, and ended up staying in California for the rest of his life as a true California pioneer, William Manly. You can read all about it in the story, not the story, but the factual account that William wrote, Death Valley 49, about his whole trip all the way out here to California and all the travails in Death Valley right over those mountains. Well, look at this little oasis on the way up to the ghost town of Darwin out of Panamint Springs. Oh, look at that. Wow. It's called China Garden Spring. That's full of goldfish in the middle of the desert. Huh. Developed by Japanese. Koi pond developed by Japanese, I guess, miners in the area. Wow. Huh. Crystal clear. There's the remains of a building right here, prior, and the remains of an operation right up there, mining operation. China Garden Springs, right outside of, well, between Panamint Springs and Darwin. Well, here we are in Darwin, California, just outside of Lone Pine. Semi-abandoned ghost town. lot of folks still out here, looks like, and a lot of stuff abandoned. Well, anyways, I hope you enjoyed this special edition of Death Valley 2015. As much as I've enjoyed coming out here and riding all this and seeing it all again. Some of it is new to me, some of it I've seen before, but it sure is fun coming out and seeing all this and seeing that some of the old American West is still here. I want to give a special thanks to Sherm Hanley for tracking me on my spot and helping me stay out of trouble as I adventure around out here far, far away from any services. And of course, my wife Jenny for coming out and riding along with me, letting me come out here and do this kind of stuff. Risking life and limb to give you the quality kind of program you've come to expect on Juan Brown Presents. There they are, the Sierra Nevada. The pioneers we're looking for.